After a stint of missionary work teaching in England, I returned to Wales to take a temporary post teaching geography at Cowbridge Grammar School, where the head teacher, Mr. Edward Rees, was a strict classics scholar. His rugby pedigree was undisputed, having played in the victorious Welsh team against the All Blacks of New Zealand in 1936. I was a little reticent, because I expected the school to be full of Oxbridge-trained teachers, and wondered whether I would be intimidated. My fears were unfounded, and I enjoyed my stay immensely. As a young bachelor, I was often in the company of two boarding masters of the time, Wyn Oliver, who was in charge of PE, and Iolo Davis, another classics man who produced the weekly newspaper, The Bovian. Iolo was a visitor from a time warp, a total eccentric, who wore cavalry twill trousers that ended some 6 inches from the ground, occasionally supported by a tie wrapped round the waist. In their shared study, any gap in the line of books on the bookshelves was filled by a half-empty whiskey bottle. Wyn was a small, vibrant West Walian who had sprinted for Wales in the Commonwealth Games of the 1950s. He was about 5'4" when he was feeling well, but he was explosive and fast as a rugby player, and no boy dared cross him. He was a pocket hand grenade. When I got to the school, they were still talking about his first day there, particularly his self-introduction to the staff. Apparently, he stood at the staff room door and started counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, until he had counted absolutely everyone. Right, he continued. A recent survey in the newspaper states that 1 in every 15 men is a practising homosexual. There are 17 in this room, so hands up the queer, so I know where I stand. Digs had been arranged for me outside the town near Crossways with a very congenial couple, Mr. and Mrs. Shepherd, who had once been in service in London. So tea and biscuits were served at 7:30 a.m. and my shoes were taken away to be cleaned. And such was the service in that digs, I put on 2 stone in 2 terms. Character in all its forms was the one criteria for appointing the staff, because they had it in spades in Cowbridge Grammar School. "Don't sit in that chair in the staff room, Roy," was one piece of advice. "That chair belongs to Darwin Adams, maths. He likes to sit there in the staff room because he can supervise his senior classy without leaving the room. He can see them through the window while he has a puff on his pipe." The head of history was a published author, although you'd never guess it by his thrifty use of words in school reports. Hopeless, or bemused, or non-historic were examples. Jeff Alden was head of geography, and I worked in his department. He was a lovely man who became a renowned local historian in Cowbridge. He died far, far too young. Sid Harris was another classics man, an ex-rugby player for Swansea, with a glint of mischief in his eye. I remember him following a staff drinking session in a town pub on our half-day holiday to celebrate St. David's Day, jumping on a letterbox and eating a daffodil in honour of our saint. He was clearly a man of honour in all things. He told me that he met his wife while she was training to be a nurse. One evening after a date, they were late getting back to the nurse's hostel and found it locked. They went in search of an open window, found one, and he helped her to clamber through. "Roy," he said, "in pushing her through the window, I inadvertently placed both my hands on her backside, just to heave, you understand, but after that, I felt committed. I felt I had to marry her." Have chalk, will travel. That was my motivation, and Penarth was one pin on my map of temporary appointments. There are tales told about Penarth that suggest it is rather a snobbish place. I never found it so. The schools at which I taught in town were always happy, convivial places. The old Penarth Grammar School had 2 staff rooms, male and female, and the males went out on a Christmas too on their own. They did not invite the women. There, Druidic circle tradition ruled, to which I and another new teacher were invested at Christmas time in a pub in Penllyn. The Archdruid was from the maths department, and we were all given a bardic name. At the end of the ceremony, we had to kneel before the Archdruid, who had the head of a bear hanging from a ribbon round his neck, Penarth being the Welsh for head of the bear. At the end of his eulogy, to both of us, he handed the head of the bear towards me and then said, "You are now known as Roy the Black Roy from the Black Mountain, and you may now kiss my arth." I duly did. Penarth featured on my life's map some years later, when Elaine and I celebrated our first wedding anniversary in a restaurant on the seafront. It was a very fine meal, and a fitting occasion, but it was the very first time that our bill had crossed the £10 barrier. Although now a married couple, we agreed not to tell our parents about the decadent cost out of sheer embarrassment and discomfort. Llantwit Major was also on my supply teaching route. I taught at St. Illtyd's Primary School, which catered for children at the RAF station in St. Athan. I had the good fortune to stay with one of the characters of the town. Her name was Mary Pierce, and she lived in the Curriers, a disenfranchised pub from the days when bars were either found on a gate or you hit someone with it. She was a woman of substance, who took her baths once a week in a tin tub out in the old stable, which had doors on one end and a gaping hole the other, where the door had once been. The Curriers is situated in Old Llantwit Major, which is a very picturesque small town. She was hardy and welcoming, providing a breakfast to take a man into a full week's toil, and being sure of herself, well, to swig a couple of bottles of Mackeson most evenings, to ward off two threats, an impending chill, and what she considered to be the root of all ills and personal tempest, constipation. I confess to having had three periods of hypochondria in my life, enjoying all of them. The first one came upon me in Llantwit Major. As I lay in bed of a night, if I wanted to visit the comfort cabin, it was at the bottom of the garden. The journey required you to put on six different light switches en route before you even got to the back door. And a cold night in January discouraged that kind of expedition anyway. But venture you did. One particularly trying night, I felt unnaturally cold, and I feared that the bed might be a little damp. I had read somewhere that being very, very cold is one of the most comfortable ways to die, and you have to be careful about letting yourself slip away. To protect myself against such inadvertent slippage, I put on a vest underneath my pyjamas, then a tracksuit on, a pair of rugby socks, a dye cap, a pair of gloves and a scarf. I also ripped some pages out of holiday brochures to stick in the window just in case there might be a draught. My Auntie Katie from Port Talbot had warned me about draughts. "Beware of draughts," she'd warned. "Draughts can get to the bones and organs, right through your pores, giving you rheumatism, pleurisy and pneumonia, years before your time." And something very strange for a spinster was her remark to me when I was on my own in my grandmother's kitchen. "A," she said, "Roy, being that you're a boy, don't you dare cross your legs until you're at least 15. Thinking back, I wish I'd listened to her now. Her words returned to me in Llantwit Major. After the draught, the imaginary damp bed and the extreme cold, I wondered whether my extra lagging had been enough. Over the next weeks, I began to have aches and pains all over the place, so I visited the doctor. It was the first time I encountered an appointment system because in Brynaman, with Dr. Warner, it had been a simple queuing system. There were regulars on Mondays, well known to the doctor, and if they didn't turn up, the doctor really thought they were ill. The doctor in Llantwit Major checked me over and couldn't find anything wrong with me at all. "Now listen," he said, "you got too many pains in too many places for it to be serious. It could be psychoneurosis." Hey, psychoneurosis, big word. That was good enough for me. "Now," he continued, "is there anything on your mind? Anything bothering you at all? Anything out of the ordinary that's filling your mind, you know, playing on your thoughts?" "Not really," I replied. "No worries, no bother. I'm coping with the plans for the wedding, all right." Wedding, marriage, eh? There we have it, you see. A change of life. Your mind is preparing for that, and your body is trying to keep up with your mind. Let me tell you now, I've been there. I've done it. I got the certificate. I can assure you that once your marriage has taken place, your aches and pains will be gone. Your mind will be totally distracted. It'll be too busy dealing with other problems.